Dobre ranno, good morning. So I thank you for the invitation to be here. It's a real pleasure to be in Brno. I confess it's my first time here in Brno, although I've been many times in the Czech Republic. But it has been a pleasure, and I mean, the whole hospitality that I've been given, it's really outstanding. So thank you very much for everything. I do appreciate it. So the challenge that I put to myself today, let's put it this way, was to talk a little bit on the work we are doing on the virtualization of radio networks, which, as you will see, is to bring a little bit the perspective of virtual networks to what is happening in radio, so which is very much physical stuff, and you cannot just put a computer doing it, but you'll see there are some links and some ways to go with this. Basically, I'll be talking according to this outline. I'll be giving you a motivation, which is, in fact, it's probably half of the talk, and I explain you why, because since I was told that the audience would be somehow diverse, I didn't want to bring too much specific things for obvious reasons. Yeah? So I'll be giving you a perspective of the evolution of mobile communications in general, and which ends up being a motivation for the work that we are doing in virtual radio networks. Then a little bit entering more into the technology stuff, what kind of architectures we need to have in order to implement these virtual radio networks, and then some very basic, let's say, information on what we are doing, the algorithms we are doing. Don't worry, I have a couple of equations, but I'm not going into details, so you don't need to be concerned with these. And some performance results, just to highlight what you can gain by using this perspective in the way that networks are managed. So, but let me start giving a general perspective on these. So, you are young guys, let's put it this way. I don't want to offend anyone, obviously. But you don't remember these. But these were the way that all computers existed many years ago. Yeah? These were the so-called mainframes and so on. And then, of course, when technology was like these, you could not have, like we have today, personal computers for obvious reasons. And then you had, of course, the personal computers, and Apple was one of the first companies, as you know, to really to start this. Okay, and the rest of the story is well known. But there's also another important thing that helped on all these spreading, let's put it this way, and massification of computers, which is obviously has to do with the operating systems. Because when you had things like these, and even when you had some things like these, you had operating systems which were done by commands. And of course, for us engineers, writing commands, it's not a problem, it's what we do in life. But for the people out on the streets, it would be very, very complex to deal with computers or even a smartphone by writing commands for obvious reasons. So when you started having the Windows or whatever operating system you can call it, and that people could go with the mouth and do things visually, of course it created one of the important things, which is the easiness of use for the mass market. And this basically is one of the main reasons, of course, why we have computers these days as we know it. Yeah? The other thing, okay, I don't know how old you are, I don't know how many of you remember these. This was the ZX Spectrum, which was really, you do, yeah? So this was really the first personal computer ever, yeah? Really. So, again, this is really old technology, guys, because this is a tape recorder, which is something no one uses today. But, so, these numbers are not a mistake, by the way. So the clock was 3.5 megahertz. The RAM was 16 kilobytes. The numbers are okay. This is not a mistake. Yeah? And it had no hard drive. So the hard drive, the equivalent to the hard drive, would be the tape recorder. And of course, we came a long way since that happened to today. And the thing that you have witnessed is basically a race in between hardware and software. Hardware has improved a lot, but software as well. And every time there's a faster computer, Microsoft and all the other guys dealing with software take advantage of these. The thing here is that I don't know how many of you know all the commands and all the things that you can do with Word. Does anyone know this? No. And I'm speaking of Word, but I can speak of something else, right? Because my point is, this race in between hardware and software has reached to the point that from the software side, we are being offered things that we are not going to use. I mean, of course they are there, but they are providing more services than we need. But of course, if you want to keep selling stuff, you need to highlight things. Okay, so this is a bit learning from computers. Let's say, if you look at how technologies have evolved, you can try to perspective a little bit how our own domain will evolve as well. Now, let me pick another example completely different from this one, which is cars. Yeah? So, you know, in the beginning, when Ford just launched the cars in the United States, he had this thing that you can pick whatever color you want for your own car as long as it's black. Yeah? So he couldn't care less about the customer. He just was providing a car. And the goal in the beginning was to have faster cars, right? He also said that I would not ask the customers what they want because they would ask me for a faster horse. And I have a car, right? So really, when cars started, the goal was to have a faster car. And for many, many years, in order to sell a car, you would see that in the advertisement, the key thing was this car will reach 100 kilometers per hour in X seconds. Because you are really taking speed as the key aspect to sell a car. But then, I don't know in the Czech Republic how it is, but in Portugal, you cannot drive above 120 kilometers. Of course, I mean, you can, but you get a ticket, right? So, and anyway, even regardless of whatever speed limits you may have, no one can drive at 500 kilometers. We don't have cars, or even if we had, we don't have roads for that. So once cars started having a certain speed, then speed was not the selling point. And the selling point started to be the comfort and the safety of the passengers. Then they start showing the interior of the car and the crash bars and all these things, right? And these days, you sell cars by energy efficiency. The key number you give to a customer these days to sell a car is the consumption, how much it consumes per 100 kilometers. So the bottom line here is speed is no longer important. No one cares about the speed to sell a car these days. So, this means that when we look at the evolution of our technology, and now that everyone talks about 5G, I dare to say that we should not follow the motto of the Olympic Games. I don't know if you are familiar with the motto of the Olympic Games, but the motto of the Olympic Games is in Latin, yeah? And it is Citius, Altius, Fortius, which means faster, higher, and stronger. So this is more of the same, but just better. And that's exactly what we should not do in mobile communications. Meaning taking speed, and when you look at the many of the things on 5G, people and the companies that are trying to sell 5G and research on 5G and so on, they keep talking about the speed, the speed, the speed. Yes, of course, we are still in the era that speed is a key parameter, because sometimes when you go to a place, you still wait minutes for downloading something which is small. So yes, definitely. But in the research area, you are not developing stuff to be done next year. Our goal is 10 years or 15 years from now, or even longer, it doesn't matter. So of course, then we need to have a perspective in which we need to have some kind of disruptive view of what we want to do and not just increasing the speed. Okay, so now let me, with all these, you can also look at another thing, which are the terminals that people use to interact with the network. Of course, this is basically, as you see, the evolution of the terminals. So this is the first or one of the first GSM phone. And it was a large phone. You could even see the antenna. You need to pull it out, right? And then what happened was that the size of the phone started decreasing because that was the goal, to have smaller and lighter phones. But then some stuff started appearing that was not just voice. And then, of course, with data, the keyboard starting to decrease, and you know the rest of the story for obvious reasons. Then the iPhone came, no physical keyboard, and then phones are even going larger because you want a large screen to do many things. So, and these days, this is the usual thing that people have. So many, many people have a laptop, they have a tablet, and they have a smartphone. And now, if you think yourselves, what's the difference in between these three devices? Meaning, what can you do with one of the devices that you cannot do with the others? I think the answer is basically nothing, right? I mean, okay, I usually use this to make a phone call, right? But couldn't I use my laptop to do it? I could, right? I mean, with Skype or VoIPBuster, all these things, I could just hear. Of course, it's not very convenient, as you can imagine, to be out on the streets carrying a laptop and talking to the laptop in the streets, right? It's much more convenient to use these. And the other way around. If I want to write a report, PhD thesis, whatever, it's much more convenient to use the laptop than the phone. But I think you can use a phone to write a report. It's not very convenient, but you can do it. I mean, you have Word in here, so what's the problem, right? So the thing is, it's much more a matter of convenience for the user of which terminals we are using, rather than not being capable of doing something. And of course, these days, you have the Google glasses, you have the Apple Watch, so you are entering really into an era of other terminals and devices and so on. So, whatever will happen in the future, we don't know. But one of the trends clearly is that we will have some kind of SIM card that is an RF SIM card. Basically, you just carry your own profile and you can interact with whatever device is available. If you think about this, this is really the trend. And even when you start having these payments in the phones and all these kind of things, what is important really is your identity and how you can use this identity to use whatever device is available. So that's clearly the trend. I don't know if you have this model from Philips, but this is, I'm sure there's a model for ladies as well. I think this is for men. But you never know what you can do with these devices these days, right? But in fact, let me tell you, or let me show you rather, a few, let's call it gadgets, but everything I'm going to show you now is on sale. You can buy it. This is a jacket. Actually, this started being on sale since 2006, so almost 10 years ago. Yeah. And this is a winter jacket that is manufactured by Burton. Burton is an American manufacturer of the clothes. And this was done in collaboration with Motorola, when Motorola was still doing these things. Yeah. And this has a built-in radio. So the FM, the radio, built in the jacket. So if you want to listen to some music, just tune on the sleeve, and then you do like this, and you listen to music. So this is on sale since almost 10 years ago. Oops, sorry about the mic. So the bottom line here is putting technology into clothes is already old thing. It's done. I mean, it's commercial. You can buy it. Then this one, probably this one is better known, yeah, which are the sneakers from Nike that were, again, in 2006. They had a Bluetooth connection to the iPod. And so you could, and then in the iPod, you had an app. At the time, it was called an app. It was not called an app, but that would check how many steps you have and the speed you're running and all these kind of things. So putting technology into shoes again, no problem. It's there since many years ago. One of the problems that you have is if you want to go out in the summer, your summer holidays, and but I want to go out in the fields, and then I cannot charge my phone, I will be... No, sorry, that's not the issue. You have this backpack, also on sale since 2006, which has solar panels in the back, so you can spend one full week in the wilderness, and you just charge your phone or whatever with this backpack. So you don't need to come down to the village to charge your devices. It's even more than that. This jacket has the solar panels in here. So you can wear this jacket, and then you can charge your phone or whatever with the connection to the jacket. So it's even more convenient. You don't even need to carry a backpack. And this one, do you know this one? This is a very small thing, like this. And it has a Bluetooth connection with the device. So you can project a keyboard wherever you want. So meaning you don't need to carry a physical keyboard, you just use these. There is also this one, which is a keyboard that is made in cloth. And this is another one. This is an app for the iPhone that is connected with a scale, a weight scale. And you need to weigh every day. And then it tells you how you are doing on your weight and all these kind of things. And this one is a wireless charger. They exist already, you can buy one. And finally, this one, which is a kind of a Swiss knife army with built in with a phone, whatever. This is not for sale, yeah. This is the one, this is a kind of a joke still, but you understand the idea, right? So with the exception of this one, everything else is technology. So the bottom line here is putting technology into daily things, clothes, shoes, whatever, is no longer a major challenge. You can do this. It's more a commercial challenge. It's more a commercial in the sense of doing it small or whatever, and of course the price, how much you are going to charge for these, because these things, of course, you don't have too many people that are willing to pay for these things. But so we need to have a broader view of what technology will evolve. Of course, why don't these things are popular like smartphones? Well, I think one of the reasons is, of course, that if you want to buy a jacket like this, for example, like this, not too many people will find it interesting because, for obvious reasons, fashion plays a major role. But you can figure out that in a few years this will be a very common thing. Right. Okay. So, what are then the services? What evolution can we see on the services? One of them is, of course, what you have on what it's called information access. As you know, the trend is that information is being carried electronically, and paper as a support for information is really disappearing, as you know. For example, there was a conference that was organized here this week, and the proceedings were given in a USB stick. No one is printing proceedings in paper anymore. I remember when I started attending my very first conferences, I'd always take the bag with, especially the large conferences, yeah? I would always take the bag with some space because I knew that I would come back home with pile of paper from the proceedings that I would put in the library and so on. And this would be really a pile of paper. And of course, these days, you have it on a USB stick. And I don't know how many of you buy a daily newspaper on paper, but probably most of you just go to the internet to check for the news, right? So paper is really disappearing as a support for communication. In a few years from now, exaggerating a little bit, but not too much, paper will be used for napkins, toilet paper, these kind of things. That's it. But not as a support for information, because this will be done electronically. Actually, there's a very nice movie. If I have time in the end, I will show you about this thing of the paper. It's an advertisement, but it's a very nice one. I will show you this. But okay, now let's look what implications this has on the network. And the implications can be large, because this means that if people are no longer, when they commute, in the train, in the bus, from the suburbs of a city to the center of the city, on a daily basis to come to work, if they used to buy the journal paper and now they are downloading the information, this means that people, instead of queuing in the kiosk to buy the paper, they are queuing in the network to download the information, right? And then you are entering the bus or you are entering the train, and that means you have tens, hundreds of people that are accessing the network, and they want to download it like this. They don't want the information to be ready when they finish the journey 20 minutes later. So the impact, it says in the network, is that you do need to have, speed is important here, in the sense that you need to serve customers for some information for a short period of time. But then probably you don't need, or you need another structure for the network, because it makes no sense that if people are all in the train station, thousands of people, they are all having access to the same newspaper that is 1,000 kilometers away. Because a copy of this daily newspaper should be in a server, probably even in the base station, in the train station, right? Because for obvious reasons. So you need to take these things into account. Another one is location awareness. Okay, you knowing where you are via your smartphone is common thing, right? Smartphones these days, they have all these apps that enable you to know where you are and all these things. But the reverse here is the trend that we need to explore, which is the network knowing where you are. And this is not for, let's say, for privacy matters. No one cares where Luis Correa is. At least I hope no one cares, because I'm not a famous politician or whatever, right? So that's not the issue, of course. But the network may use me as a sensor for many things. I don't know how many of you know the traffic layer of Google Maps. You know the traffic layer of Google Maps? So in Google Maps, you have several layers. One is the traffic layer. And the traffic layer enables you to see where are the traffic jams in real time. How do you think this is done? Do you think Google has people sitting on the streets and taking notes if there is a traffic jam? Obviously not. They are making use of us. When you download something in Android, and there's this very small, inoffensive, harmless message, do you allow the network to make use of your location? And most people say yes. Then you are being used as a sensor to the network, in this case for the traffic of the layer of Google Maps. So our phones can and should be used, of course, again, privacy matters apart, as sensors to the network. We can estimate, we are 20 people in this room, this can be a good estimation of the channel in this room. And the network can accommodate the transfer of the information according to these. And this would make the network more efficient. Then the other one is the Internet of Things. I'm sure you heard about this, that's not the issue. So basically, this means that you have, of course, machines talking to each other and so on, and you can program your refrigerator when it's less than 5 beers. Yeah, it automatically orders beers to the supermarket. Okay, this is all the stuff of the machine-to-machine and Internet of Things. But this also means that you have, much more data flowing in the networks with completely different requirements. Because you have, okay, this one of the beer is not a problem if it delays for 2 hours, because, okay, I think we can wait 2 hours for a beer. But if you have applications that are a kind of alarm, then the amount of information is very small, but you need to deliver it instantaneously, let's say this way. So you need to take all these things into account. So when you talk about Internet of Things or machine-to-machine or machine-type communications, whatever you want to call it, you really need to distinguish in between them for the specific requirements that they have. And when you enter all the area of the sensor networks for personal things, again, this is a completely new field. These days, this is, again, okay, this picture here is very complicated, but if you go to some areas, like sports, for example, there are already some sports that people, the people meaning the sports people, the pilot in the cars, for example, Formula One, whatever, they have already a lot of sensors. And people are tracking what's happening. The heart pressure, the blood pressure, the heartbeat, all these things are being tracked and measured. So you can imagine, and if you have an Apple Watch, the Apple Watch, I don't have one, but I read that it has some sensors, and then you can have already some of these parameters. So imagining that in the future you will have other things like buttons in your jacket or in here in the sleeve, whatever, of your shirt, again, it's a matter of time. These things will happen. And this can be used not only for entertainment, not only for medical applications, but also for entertainment. Because, and people are usually willing to pay a lot of money for entertainment. Then, of course, you have all the things dealing with vehicular communications. And this is, again, a huge field of applications, not only in between vehicles, but in between the vehicles and infrastructure. And this is already happening again, or starting to happen, not only for security reasons of travel, but also, again, for downloading entertainment and all these kind of things. Then you have the body area networks, again, very much connected with the sensors, the personal sensors, with a huge range of applications, not only medical ones, but again, even beyond entertainment, you have things like firemen entering into a building and they have sensors in the clothes. If they are in distress or they have problems, this can automatically trigger something, or military or police. So there are many, many applications around this area again. And all of these needs to be connected to a network in an efficient way. Everyone talks about smart cities, which is a major hat for talking about many applications, diverse applications in a city by integrating infrastructures in a city. You can have, for example, emergency warnings. Let's say it's very stupid that these days, with all the technology that we have, we are not capable. Imagine, of course, knock on wood, yeah? Imagine there's a fire in this building now. There's no way that we can use a very basic technology like SMS to send an MS to everyone that is in this building and saying, get out, there's a fire, right? But this is, there's no technological barrier that prevents us from doing this. It's just the commercial agreements in between operators and all these kind of things. So these things tend to, of course, to move in that direction, and you have many, many applications in inclusion, intelligent transportation system, environment, smart grids. All these things are moving in the same direction, meaning we are, in fact, going to increase a lot the number of applications, the flow of data that we have in the networks, and with completely different requirements. And networks need to adapt to these. That's the basic thing. Of course, you can go a little bit more in the future on the applications. One is the mobile 3D internet. This one is not yet for sale, but probably it will be in the future, like holograms or something like that. You can have a device with some 3D stuff. Okay, this is probably close to Star Wars still at the moment. But the problem is, the bottom line here is not the device, is that if you want to do these, you need to transfer a lot of information, because having 3D information obviously is much more than 2D or 1D. So the amount of information you need to flow in the network will be much larger. You have real-time ad hoc communities, which is something that you already have these days, some apps that enable you to do this. But this is being done via some app that is stored in a central server. This means real-time ad hoc communities, means that you can imagine there's a colleague of mine here in the same building, and he doesn't know I'm here and the other way around. But the network can detect we are here and can send an SMS or a warning, whatever, saying you guys are here because I'm on his personal list of phones, contacts, whatever, and the reverse. So there's a lot of stuff, and all these things will be happening again without us touching any button, right? You just put the settings and that's it. Presumers, I don't know, do you know this word, presumers? Presumers is when you put together producers and consumers. That's what basically we are doing these days in the network, more and more. The networks, when you start, let's say, with data in mobile communications or in networks in general, the ratio in between the download and the upload was 10. So the speed for upload was 10 times smaller than for the download. And the reason was very simple, because we as users would download much more information than we upload. But this has completely changed, because these days with the social networks, the social media, meaning the YouTubes, the Twitters, all this Instagram, I mean, you name it, you have it, right? Facebook, everything else. You are putting a lot of information on the networks. And this means that this ratio from the upload to the download, uplink, downlink, has gone much smaller. And if you look at LTE, for example, LTE already foresees a ratio of 1:2. And this is very important, in fact, because these days, if you look at the news, many times when there are things that are not foreseen, in which you can have a TV crew going there and so on, like a disaster or something like that, many times the first images and even videos that you see are videos and images taken by people out on the streets with their phones. And just they film it and then they upload it. So this will, again, this will bring a huge, is already bringing, and it will be much more, a huge impact on the networks, because the networks need to be prepared for this. Then you have context awareness, which is basically using your mobile phone or device, whatever you want to call it, to sense how you are and to improve your quality of life. And this is done basically not only on the physical aspects, but the social or psychological one. And okay, you are not in a good mood, but how can the phone know this? Well, if you have the sensors of the heartbeat and the blood pressure and all these things, you can extrapolate some ways how people are feeling. If you are anxious, your heartbeat starts increasing, for obvious, right? So there are things that you can do these. Then you can have interactive games. And in here, you can think about people playing a game to kill aliens in this room, right? And then you think, yeah, why should I do this? Okay, maybe not you, but there are guys killing aliens in, or whatever, right, in these computer games. Now, the thing is, in this room, why not? I mean, Google, going back to Google, Google has Google Earth and Street View, which means that you can already see a lot of things. And Google is already doing, I don't know, I'm sure in Prague they have done it almost for sure. I don't know if you know this, Google is already mapping the interior of public buildings. Exactly the same perspective as Street View. So having 3D images of buildings, with this room for example, is not that much. It's already happening. So if you take advantage of this information to put games on the top of it, it's just a matter of time. Then you have augmented reality, and Google Glass is already where providing these, which is of course to put a lot of information on the glasses on the top of what you have, and then you can identify a lot of things. And then of course you can even go with other things that are closer to the network and so on. So let me skip this one. So the bottom line now is the following. Up to now, we have been using networks in the perspective of one size fits all. You have one network, LTE, UMTS, whatever, and it's used for all applications. And we know, as a general thing in engineering, that there is no such thing as the universal panacea. So if you want to have efficiency in the networks, we need to have dedicated networks for some applications according to the requirements. Because if we don't, then we'll be in trouble. In trouble meaning we are wasting resources, we are not being efficient. So that's where we start coming to new ways of looking at networks and communications. So one of them, of course, is spectrum sharing. We still live in a world of frequencies for cellular communications being in a license band. So cellular operators, they pay a lot of money to have frequencies in a band, but then these frequencies are their own. No one else is allowed to transmit there. And as you know, Wi-Fi is unlicensed, so everyone can use Wi-Fi, and when you buy a port or an access point for Wi-Fi, you can buy it in a supermarket. Right? You can buy these in supermarkets. And you go back home and you connect it, and that's it. It's running. No problem. Well, no problem, let's see if there's no problem, because I can tell, for example, in my building, if I make the sniffer, if I put the sniffer of the Wi-Fi, even with the other guys on the other side of the street, I can sense or I can capture something like 38, almost 40 access points. And this means I have a problem at home, which is obviously interference. Obviously, right? There are no miracles here. So this thing about the usage of spectrum and the sharing of spectrum needs to be done carefully. And everyone talks about refarming and all these kind of things, but in fact, there are many things that need to be done now. Some of them are very obvious. I was told by a colleague, an American colleague, that one of the things that United States is going to do is to reallocate some of the frequencies for the military. And one of the reasons is very simple. The United States Navy has some dedicated bands. Now, the United States Navy obviously does not need to use these frequencies when they are inland, right? I mean, I'm sure you know the map of the United States. You can imagine the United States, they have water on the east and the west, but that's it. So there's no Navy in Utah or I don't know where in the middle of the United States. So why on earth are these frequencies locked there for the United States Navy? It makes no sense. So there's a lot of frequencies. There are a lot of frequency bands that can and should be used for other things. There's another perspective here, which is you can even go one step further. And I'm sure at least some of you heard about cognitive radio and all these kind of technologies. But there is another thing we can even do, which is, for example, with radars. You have these rotating radars in airports. Right? Now, a radar rotates, obviously, to track the aircraft. Now, and this takes, let's say, 1 minute or 50 seconds, whatever. Some of you may know that these antennas are very, very, the beam width is very, very narrow because you want to detect the place of the location of the aircraft. So we are talking here about beam widths, half power beam widths in the order of 2-3 degrees. Very, very narrow. So which means that even if you put 10 degrees, just for as a safety margin, you still have 350 degrees in which you can communicate, assuming that you have some interference control here. So the antenna is rotating. You can use the time of these 350 degrees to communicate in a very efficient way. If you deal with the absence of interference, absence in comas, of course, if you control the interference in this case, there's a perfect system in which you can send data, for example. Not voice. If you try to do voice here, probably is not the best thing, because voice, you want to do it continuously. But to carry data for, I don't know, the power meters for the smart grids. It's something that you don't need to do continuously. The quality of service you need for a service like this is, let's say, low. So you can use this band for these. So As you see, there are many new perspectives you can and should use on spectrum sharing. Another one, of course, is the networks of information. It's basically you start having the networks drawn in a way, the architecture networks that is based on objects. Based on objects means that these days when you look for information, you give an IP address. And the idea is that instead of giving an IP address, you'll be giving a name of an object. And this object can be stored in many, many places. And of course, then you need a mapping of the storing. But this will solve, let's put it this way, the problem of the newspaper on the guys commuting on a daily basis. Because you're looking not for the IP address of the server that has stored the file of the newspaper, but you're looking for the newspaper itself, regardless of where it can be stored. The other one is the network, in network management, which is, you can call it also the self-management or self-organized networks. There are many words for these, of course, which basically is the plug and play that we know for the USB sticks, right? You guys, I don't know how many of you remember, but this thing of putting a stick here and everything is automatic, it's new. Let's call it new. Because in former times, you would have to bring a diskette and install a program and then check it. Okay, I'm not jealous of these days, but these were the days, right? So you can use this, let's say, USB perspective in the networks. We can just bring your own access point, your own base station, and interacts with the rest of the network and then automatically deals with not only with the frequency management, but also with the connection with the rest of the network. The backhaul, the front haul, all these things. Then the next one is cloud networking, not cloud computing. It's not the same thing. Of course, they are related. But cloud networking, which basically is bringing the concept of cloud computing to the networks. This means that these days, and I'm going to show you an example of this, these days, 90-something percent of a network is computers, right? Are computers. So the thing of having the operator having a bunker in the basement of a building with all these computers, which are the nodes, the various nodes you have in a, you know, the gateways, the switching centers, all this kind of stuff you have in the architecture of the current mobile cellular networks, why not use the principles of mobile computing? And this means that the management of these networks can be done by nodes that are computers, yes, but they don't necessarily need to be there. And you can even do these in a way that, in order to save energy, you can do this according to the weather or to the time of the day, meaning you can, some years from now, don't ask me when, you can have a business model in which the management of networks is being done in computers that are during the night, which means that, of course, if it's day now, meaning the management of the network is not being done by computers here in the Czech Republic, but can be done, I don't know, in Japan, right? And then when it's night here and day in Japan, the computers here are doing this. Of course, you need very fast connections and all these things, but it's a matter of time until this happens. There are restrictions of delay and so on. I don't want to say that it's easy and there are no problems to be solved, but also that's why we are doing research, right? Because there are many problems here to be addressed in order to achieve these things. Then on the top of these, we have network virtualization, which is basically the reason why I'm now talking about in the next minutes, which is creating virtual networks. So virtual networks, the idea is to have a layer in between, let's say, the physical stuff and the services and the management of the networks. And with this layer, you can, in the same physical infrastructure, you can define different networks, different logical networks, call it this way, which can be used for different purposes. And then you take much more efficient perspective of the infrastructure that is available, and then with these you use the resources better. And everyone is happy. Operators are happy because they spend less money. Probably the vendors will not be happy if they just sell the equipment, but these days they are also selling the services, so they will be happy as well because they will be selling the services for these, and you are using the networks much more efficiently. And then you can just set up a network during 2 hours in the night, and you don't care which infrastructure is being used again, you just want the network to get the readings of the power meters for the smart grids. That's a network. And the power company is using this network just 2 hours a night, and you get all the readings. And then you can have networks for many other things. And this way you are fitting the networks, we come back to the beginning, to the requirements of the services and applications to the different requirements. You can have a network with a very strict and very narrow requirement, let's put it this way, on delay, for example, if it's something for alarms. But for the power meters, you don't care about delay. It's just getting the daily usage of the electricity, whatever. Okay, it didn't come at 3, it came at 3:30. What's the problem? I don't need this data in a hurry, let's put it this way. Yeah. So these are a few solutions, let's say, in order to solve the problems that I identified in the beginning for all these services and so on. And now I'm coming really to the initial part of my talk, virtual networks and what we are doing in radio. I'm spending too much time in my talk, I'm sorry. Should I speed up or a little bit? A little bit. You get enthusiastic, you know. In Portuguese, we have a saying that talking and eating, you never end, so you don't stop. So I'm sorry. Okay, so what are then the objectives of, the research we are doing is to put a layer, a software layer, on the top of the physical resources, meaning the channels, meaning time slots, codes, frequencies, whatever. Putting a software layer on the top of these, and this software layer will put to everything else in the network, will just give megabit per second, which is what people want, and delays and so on, all these parameters. But no one then needs to know about things like time slots or codes or what frequencies we have. That's a problem for the lower layers, for the infrastructure. So this means that this is what you have right now. So you have, these days, you have devices that are connected to base stations. These base stations are connected to some control, which these days in LTE, for example, some of these functionalities are even part of the base station. And then, of course, you have something dealing with the radio resource management. And then it goes up to the rest of the network. So the idea is that, again, you put a layer here on the top of the physical network. And this layer will connect to different physical radio access techniques, meaning this one can be GSM, this one can be Wi-Fi, this one can be LTE and so on, whatever you have there. It really doesn't matter. Because once you put this software layer in here, then everything else, you can have just service providers on the top of these. This will even change the business models of communications, because you can have guys that just own the infrastructure and they sell services to the service providers, which will be virtual network operators. Can be the power company setting up the network just for 2 hours during the night. Now, from the logical network viewpoint, then people will be connected to a virtual base station. And the virtual base station is the collection of the physical base stations that are there. But of course, the user doesn't even know, like today, to which base station is being connected. And there's a virtual resource manager here, which has a virtual network, and then you have the service provider. So this software layer that you have in the networks enables, again, to make a separation, an isolation, in between the actual physical infrastructure and everything else in the network. And with this, you can set up many, many networks according to these. So, and then, in the end, you have what you can call virtual links, which is Physically, you are connected to a base station, obviously. You cannot replace the laws of physics. You can do a lot of research, but the laws of physics are always there. But logically, you are connected to a virtual base station. So this is a little bit like, okay, it's not the same thing, but in former times, when you had these cards from the banks, you would have a card from your own bank. And you could use your ATM machine just from your bank, and that was it. These days you have, many years ago of course, you have Visa or MasterCard, you have the credit cards, which you buy from a bank, but you are not connected to your own bank, right? You can withdraw cash from your bank, but you can withdraw cash. I mean, I can come from Portugal like I did. I come here to an ATM machine and I take Czech crowns. It's as easy as that, right? So all the complexity of the network has disappeared. I have a virtual network operator, which is Visa, and I'm using the physical infrastructure of a bank here in the Czech Republic, but that is transparent for me. This is an ATM machine. I put the card, I get cash, or I pay some expenses. Whether, again, in former times, you would have to, okay, you know how it was. So that's a little bit what you have. And in order to do this, we need to do something else, which is the Cloud Run. So you need to separate, if you look what's happening these days, basically, again, you cannot virtualize the laws of physics. So what you need to do is, in the base stations, you need to separate what it's called the remote radio heads, which are just the physical stuff. So you have an antenna, you have an amplifier, you have a digital, analog to digital converter, all these things. But then, once you get down to the baseband, or an intermediate frequency, it really doesn't matter, you put everything on a fiber, and you deliver these to a baseband processing unit. And these things today are still in the base stations, but now they can be away. And then you have one computer here in this room that is doing the processing of the whole network in Brno. You don't need to have all these processing units in each of the base stations. So that's the way you do it. Because this then, again, virtualizing this, it's very easy because, you know, there are bits, these are computers, you can do this. So what do we have here now? So we have the virtualization of networks. We have the virtualization of the radio access network, which is dealing, this software layer is a specific part of the global aspect of virtual networks. And of course, then we can talk about virtual radio resources, which is the equivalent of the resources we have in megabit per second mapped onto the actual physical channels that of course continue to exist. So if you want, this is a little bit like the virtual machines in computers. You have, okay, you can have the sharing of a machine. You have a computer, you have the operating system, and then you can run several applications or programs in a computer. That's what every computer does. But what you can do is you can have the virtualization of computers, virtual machines. And when you have virtual machines, you have the hardware. You install a software layer, firmware layer, whatever you want to call it. And then you can have several operating systems. And in fact, for example, the many Macs already have these. In a Mac, you can have the Mac OS and the Windows running in parallel. So you have two operating systems there. And they are sharing the same core, the same drive, hard drive, everything. And then, of course, on the top of these, you have the applications, the programs. So the idea is that you do exactly the same with the radio access network. These days, you have run sharing in between the operators. So you have the physical infrastructure, and then they share the run. But then it goes to any different core, meaning every different operator. I don't know here in the Czech Republic how is the situation, but in Portugal, for example, in the underground and a few places, the operators are, the cellular operators are forced to share the infrastructure. They were not allowed to go to the underground in Lisbon and each one installs its own antennas and so on. They said, no, no. We would like our customers to have communications in the underground, but we want a unique infrastructure. This is a very specific infrastructure. We don't want this full of antennas and cables and so on. So they are sharing the infrastructure. Now, if you want the virtualization of the RAN, it's again the same principle. You have the physical infrastructure. You are going to put the virtual manager, equivalent to this virtual machine. And then you have the virtual RANs, which again is this software layer that managing the software. And then you can connect to the cores, whatever it is. So it's somehow equivalent how you can virtualize this. OK. So now we can talk about virtual network operators, which are the guys providing services and take advantage of these virtual networks. And then we can also talk of virtual RAID resource manager, which is a very specific thing in this structure that will map the requirements from the virtual network operators and their service level agreements, meaning I want a network with a maximum delay of 10 microseconds, or I want a network with a minimum of 10 megabit per second, or whatever requirements you have. And these will be mapped on the physical infrastructure. And then the physical infrastructure has to cope with these. Because this is not as easy as it seems. Because, for example, as you know, we have fading. Yeah? So fading means that the signal is not constant, it changes, and so on and so forth. That's why you have adaptive modulation encoding in cellular networks these days. But if you have a network that says, I want a minimum, I have an application, and I need at least 10 megabits per second. So you don't care how many users there are. You don't care where users are. You need to provide these users 10 megabit per second. So if the channel is very bad, you just need to put more channels, the physical channel. If it's good, you can use one. But that's a problem for the physical infrastructure and the manager of the virtual resources. But you need to take this into account in order to fulfill the service level agreement of that particular operator. So you need to be managing the radio resources according to the physical characteristics of the propagation of the signals and so on. You need to use the different services and the different requirements and take them into consideration. And, of course, different VNOs may have different service level agreements. And you need to take all of these into account. I have a few equations, but again, I'm not going into details, but I just want to highlight some of the principles behind these. So one of the things is, for example, that you may have two major types of communications. One is the guaranteed. Again, you say, I guarantee you 99% of the time, 10 megabit per second. The other is what you can call best effort. Best effort is, I'm doing my best. And if my best is zero, you take zero. It's my best, right? Best effort. And this can be nice for some things, but obviously it's not applicable for others. These are kind of two extremes. There are many other ways, but just for you to have an idea, really, of what you can have here. Then you can have, even for the service level agreements, you can have something like a guaranteed bit rate with a maximum value. So you are imposing a minimum and a maximum. And you, now you can say, a maximum? I mean, is not all you can eat? No, sometimes it's not. Would you give 100 megabits per second to someone doing VoIP? Obviously not, right? You don't need. I mean, VoIP. If you have 100 kilobits per second, it's huge quality, let's put it this way. It's like streaming in video. Even if you are doing streaming of high definition video, it's the same thing. Okay, if you have 5 or 10 megabit per second, it's already excellent streaming. Why would you give 1 gigabit per second to a guy doing streaming? You don't need that. So you can put as one of the conditions, depending if you are designing your network. If your network has 100 customers, which are the guys with the power meters, and you know the data rate that is required, you don't need to contract all you can need to the infrastructure. You know, I mean, the maximum I need is 100 megabits per second. So that's what I'm going to contract. And then, of course, again, you can have best effort with minimum guarantee, which means that if there's a minimum, the maximum is all you can eat, and that's fine if you're doing download of files, for example, which, of course, it's fine. But even in here, it depends. Because if you are downloading a file, and you notice if a file is being downloaded, and the time it takes to download is 1 second or 1 minute. Everyone noticed this, right? And obviously, all of us prefer 1 second to 1 minute. Do you notice the difference between 1 microsecond and 1 nanosecond? No, right? It's like the cars. Speed is no longer important. If we start downloading information and the time to download information is below, let's say, 10 milliseconds, we don't notice it. If these are applications that are human sensitive, everything happening below, let's say, 10 milliseconds, we don't notice it. Or, okay, some things we have reactions up to 1 millisecond, but still, below 1 millisecond, forget it. So downloading files at 1 microsecond, 1 nanosecond, we don't care, we don't notice it. It's a waste of resources to do it. So we need to take this into consideration. Okay, now you need to take a lot of things into consideration, like the network configuration, the profile of the users. There are many different users, and you should take the usage, or the way users get and use the apps and so on, the services into consideration. The services themselves, the different VNOs that you need to take into consideration. Then, just for you to have an idea how you deal, for example, with the laws of physics, let's call it this way. You can say that, for example, you have an optimistic approach, and all your users have a channel or are in a situation that the channels that they are using enable them to get a data rate that is between half and the full data rate of that physical channel. So I'm not talking about the physical channels. So this has to do, again, with adaptive modulation encoding. But this is obviously optimistic. A pessimistic one would be, let's say, the reverse. Is that users have a data rate which is between zero and half of the maximum, which this can be considered pessimistic. So you can, let's say, have a realistic approach and say, okay, half of the users have good channels, the other half have bad ones. If you put a statistical perspective on the top of these, because you need statistics on these, you don't have the propagation of signals is not deterministic, then you can start playing around with these and develop the models and so on. So that's what we have done. I mean, I'm not, I haven't put the equations here to explain them. That's not the issue. But just for you to be aware that you can get an objective function, which you optimize. You need to separate the cell networks from the wireless LANs because, as you know, the characteristics are different. So you cannot deal with them in the same way. So you need to separate these. But you can put the cell networks in the same function, because there are the basic principles of networks and so on are the same. Then, of course, you need to optimize these things. Obviously, that the data rates provided by all the networks need to be less or equal than the maximum physical capacity that you have. There are no physical miracles here. You cannot get energy from nowhere or whatever. So these are the constraints that you need to take into consideration. Then this is a little bit like cooking. You put a little bit of salt, of pepper, some onion, tomatoes, whatever. I'm joking, right? Okay, this doesn't matter what the equation is. Is that you can optimize equations, so the functions that we have, we can optimize this. And you need to take something which is fairness into consideration. And fairness here means that when you have all the resources and you are providing the resources to users, you should account for some resources that enable, for example, the poor guy that has best effort that is going to be served after, let's say, 5 minutes if he never got a service, a channel after 5 minutes because all the other guys were VIPs, whatever, doesn't matter. then after 5 minutes, no, you get the channel after 5 minutes. So that's the fairness you need to put into this as well, is to make sure that under certain constraints, all users are served according to some criteria that you'll be defining. Okay, I need a few more minutes, but then I'll finish. So now some scenarios and some examples, results of what we have done. So this is for an example of a scenario in which you can see we have here 4 networks that are superimposed. So we have the black ones, which are, let's say, the GSM. It's the GSM network. Then you have the blue one is the UMTS. And the cells are shorter, or smaller, rather. Then this is the green ones are LTE, even smaller cells. And then these ones, which are, OK, these smaller ones here are the wireless LANs. And then depending where the user is, the user can have access to all the networks or some of them. That's a geographical problem. Let's call it this way. But then this is the physical infrastructure. And then on the top of this, you put everything else, as I told you. So for example, if you have no virtualization, the data rate, this is the average cluster serving data rate. So it's when you pick all these base stations in a given area, you can see what is the data rate that is being performed in all the base stations and access points that are within this cluster, and for this profile of users and so on and so forth. And of course, this is the standard when you start virtualizing, depending how you do it, if it's guaranteed, best effort, and so on. I will not get into details. Of course, you get a better usage of the network because you are making things more efficient. You are using all the resources of these physical networks as much as you can with this virtualization aspect. And you have another example here, which is the split in between the guaranteed and the best effort, because then you can have several splits of these networks, and of course they will have an impact on the network. So you need to play around with these things. It's not that obvious how you do the splitting, because again, this depends on the kind of networks that you have. And these will be dynamic, because again, depends how these networks are established. Again, the network for the power meters of the smart grid is something you're running in the night. So this network will exist only for 2 hours. But then you can do it the other way around. You can have a network for the intelligent transportation system, for example, for the bus. And the bus are usually running during the day. I don't know in Brno if you have buses in between 1 or 5 a.m., but probably not, right? Yes. You have? OK. In Lisbon, we don't. In Lisbon, we don't. I think the buses stop at 1, and they start at 5:30 or something like that. Yeah, OK, we don't have it. And the underground is also closed in between, I think, 1 and 5 a.m. or something like that. But that's not the point. The point is that, see, if these guys are not running, the resources of this network can be used for something else. The physical infrastructure is there. Just put another virtual network to take advantage of these resources. Why should the guys in the bus have their own network? It's a waste of resources, right? So you need to take advantage of these. OK, just another reference scenario. Just, of course, we can play around with all these things. So it's basically the same thing. You have several cells, different numbers of cells. It really doesn't matter. But I just want to show you something which I think is interesting as well. So some of you at least are familiar with the classes of services from UMTS, the 3G1. So conversational is basically voice. Streaming is, streaming. Interactive is basically the stuff you do like web browsing, so the user is waiting for the information. And background is email. You send something, you don't know when it's going to be received, but it's background. And then, of course, it's the fairness. I told you, you need to have here a small percentage of the resources that can be for the fairness. For example, for these, but of course, you can, again, play around with these things. So 40% of the people are making phone calls. Then 30% are doing streaming. This is percentage of people. As you can imagine, OK, I don't have it here, but if you look at the impact this has on the network, it's completely different, right? Because VoIP, then if you look at the volume of the information, VoIP probably is just a very tiny thing, and this one will occupy almost everything because it's streaming, and streaming needs much higher data rates and so on. Okay, and then these are things. So what, just for you to see, for example, what's happening here. So this is what happens. So these are the data rates that you have globally for the services, depending on the number of subscribers. And this is when all users are using when we have the conversational services, so basically voice there. And you see that when you have a small number, okay, these are the maximum and the minimum data rates that are to be expected with the guaranteed perspective. And you see that if you, for this mixture, right? If you look at what's happening with the guys doing the conversational service, what happens is when the number of users increases, the guys with the pessimistic channels, see, they start having a lower data rate, but because this is conversational, and we need, these guys need to have the resources, they don't go below the minimum. So the service is still being offered. Probably not with a high data rate voice quality, but people can still talk. Whether, if you look at background, see what's happening? This is what we call a violation of the contract, or it may not be, depending what kind of contract. Because when, of course, when you increase the number of users, at a certain point in time, there are no physical resources available because you are using all the channels, physical channels that are available. So these poor guys are already below the minimum. And if you continue with these, of course, all the others will be the same. So virtualization does not present any miracles of putting channels or capacity where it does not exist. It just enables a more efficient usage of the resources, which is a different thing. Okay, and now it's another way of looking at this. See, this is the violation with the number of cells. So if you start, let's say, put it this way, you have 12 cells of LTE, and this is Wi-Fi. I don't remember now if it's LTE or Wi-Fi in the cluster, it doesn't matter. With 12 cells, it's fine. There are no violations, everyone is happy. If you start decreasing the number of cells in the cluster that I've shown you in the beginning, then you can see that immediately the background enters into violation. There are no resources again. And all the others also start entering into violation, depending on the class of service. Because again, there are no physical resources available. Conclusions. So sorry I took 15 minutes more than I should. So basically, as you see, the evolution of services and everything else is really imposing major challenges on network architectures. We don't know about the future, no one knows, but we can see some trends, and we can try to get solutions for the trends that we have these days. Clearly, one of the solutions that is being presented these days is the virtualization of the networks, and what we are working these days is the virtualization of radio resources, which together with cloud networking is really a very efficient way for the usage of heterogeneous networks. And you can really get very nice capacity gains. Okay, I would like to finish also with some quotes. Yeah, to finish all of these. You probably know this one. Do you know this quote? It's very famous. These are very famous quotes. I'm not inventing anything here. This quote is from Thomas Watson, which was the CEO of IBM in 1943, many, many years ago. Yeah? And although the guy was in IBM, and IBM does not need any presentation, he had this famous quote that I think there is a world market for maybe 5 computers. Of course, this is in 43. Yeah? We know what happened, but we also know that IBM, as you know, no longer manufactures computers, right? So IBM, they clearly, we're not thinking like this, but they took the Darwin perspective. Remember Darwin? You know, who survives? Not the stronger, not the faster, not the larger, but the ones that adapt. These are the guys that survive in the evolution of species, the ones that adapt. So IBM adapted, and they are still running very good business. Does anyone remembers Digital Equipment Corporation? You do? Digital Equipment Corporation was, during the mainframe era, they were the main competitors of IBM. We had a lot of VAX machines, that was the name, V-A-X, VAX machines, the VAX computers, were really competing with the IBM computers. I mean, and for IBM were the computers for industry, and the VAX were the computers for industry and academia. So any university would like to have a VAX machine. I worked with some of these things. And these guys, now it becomes serious because he said 77, it's not 43. Kenneth Olsen was the CEO of DEC, Digital Equipment Corporation, at the time. And he saw no reason why anyone would want a computer in their home. When they woke up for the personal computer era, it was too late. They were not prepared for it. They start asking an Italian company that also disappeared, Olivetti. I don't know if any of you heard about Olivetti. Olivetti was doing computers for DEC. Too late. It's, you know, other stories like the Nokia phones, it's exactly the same thing. So these guys did not adapt in due time, they died. They went bankrupt. So, but I don't want to end with a negative message, by no means. Obviously not. So I would like to finish with a positive message, which is the one from a colleague of ours from UCLA. And he had this famous quote, which is, "The best way to predict the future is to invent it ourselves." So, thank you very much. It was a pleasure to be here.
Thank you very much, Lush, for a great, inspiring talk. So I'm pretty sure that there are some questions. So, maybe I can give it a try. Thank you all for sharing and also support AG.
Thank you.
You made an excellent analogy between access, resource sharing, and the banking world. So I would like to expand a bit on the banking and your association with infrastructure sharing, because indeed you said that sharing is possible and it is happening, for example, in Portugal as a fourth scenario in the underground. And that we also see in Finland in banking, like for example, all of the banks would use a separate manufacturer for the ATMs and everybody would use the same network of ATMs no matter what bank you work with. So there is no other ATM than this forced you know, manufacturer. But we don't see that in Russia, for example, where it's not regulated. And that was like, before in the old days, it was like everybody was using only the ATMs of their own bank. Then, of course, it was possible to migrate between those, but the fee was quite high, so people still prefer that. And then there was an idea of making a universal a network of ATMs that the people use and all the banks would kind of be involved, and it didn't work. There were ATMs, there was hardware, I mean, it was usable, it was working, and was getting some fees, but then they died out. Just because they were not available in the places where users needed those. So you see, there wasn't regulated, that was a very good idea, but how would the banks be sure that the hardware is there when they need it, when the users would need it? So there is no feedback loop in the quality assurance then. So all the same, what did happen with the virtual resources? What would you think? Because I think it's a kind of an interesting analogy.
Yes, there, of course there are, can I say, there are regulation aspects in here which are very important. If you want to materialize these, as I said, you need to change the way that business is done, because these days you have virtual network operators, as you may know, but virtual network operators these days, do you have any in the Czech Republic?
No.
You do? But these guys, they are just basic using the infrastructure of one operator. And the only thing they have on the side is the billing, right? They get everything else is the, and sometimes they even just charge, or they use the billing of the, let's say, the physical operator and just get the file on the side. So, and of course, this is not this that we are talking about. It's completely different.
Yeah.
And then regulation here will play a major role for sure. Because regulation will need to impose operators that, for example, the resources are being used where they need it. Because if you have these, and then you have an operator that owns an infrastructure, and the guy is not willing to rent his infrastructure, or whatever you want to call it, to other operators, then you may have a hole.
Exactly.
And then if you have a hole, then you have a problem.
So the customers are not happy with you, but in fact you can't do anything because the hardware is not there.
Yes. Yes. So this means that from the regulation viewpoint, you need to impose some things like the sharing of infrastructure for everyone.
But so then, you only see that in a controlled or semi-controlled fashion in the
week. I think.
Or at least in the first stage of maturing.
Yes.
But it's not competitive, right? So when it's forced, it's not...
No, because then the competition is in the virtual network operators. That's where the competition is. So that's where the guys will be competing. So the infrastructure is just providing a service. But it's like the ATM machines. In Portugal, the banks, the ATM machines are part of a company that is owned by all the banks. And this company is in charge of the machines. And there is competition in the banks. But the competition in the banks is in the services they provide to customers, not in the machines. The machines are there, are the physical infrastructure.
So you only see that through the decoupling of a business model in a way, such as
yes.
An intermediate company.
Yes, I think so.
That's what they agree with. I mean,
yes.
Only with that can be actually accomplish that vision. Otherwise, I mean, in the open market, it might not fly.
Yes. But again, the trend for sharing infrastructure is already there. There are some countries, especially for LTE, in which you have operators that are starting operation in LTE sharing infrastructure. In the UK, you have two operators fully sharing the 4G, the LTE infrastructure. The same here in the Czech Republic? Okay. No, not forced. It was their own decision. No. By no means. You had two companies that are competing in 2G and 3G. And in 4G, in order to save money, they decided, let's share the infrastructure. Yes, because it's too expensive. But then, in the advertisement, they are fighting each other. You wouldn't see in the advertisement they are sharing the infrastructure. But they are actually sharing the physical infrastructure. So the trend is there again. And if you look at the pressure that operators have these days on reducing costs, for obvious reasons, I mean, everyone is reducing costs, and especially operators, because, I mean, I didn't talk about this, but I'm sure you have seen many times this the log and exponential curve. You know what I'm talking about? That the revenue is log and the volume of data is exponential, which is the consequence. Because of the flat rates, we are not paying more for the usage, but data is increasing for all the things that I mentioned that you know. So the system is not converging, right? It's diverging. So the only way that operators can cope with this is to reduce the costs of owning and managing the network. Yes, but then it's not easy because either you have all operators changing the tariffs at the same time, which this will be against competition, so no regulator in Europe at least will accept that. Then if one goes from the flat rate to a pay-per-use, it's dead, right? Because people are used to the flat rate. And it will be very difficult to explain to a customer, even if this would be the case, that the pay-per-use will be cheaper than the flat rate. Because mentally, we are used to the flat rate. It's very nice. I mean, in your budget, domestic budget, OK, I'm paying 50 euros for communications. That's it. Pay-per-use, OK, some months I pay 20, but then I go on holidays, I will talk a lot, and then I pay 100 or 200. And no one wants that, right? So it will be a tough game for operators, for sure. You're welcome.
Any other questions?
I would like to ask. Well, so if all the operators have access to the same common technical infrastructure, yeah, so all the technical infrastructure is the same, then there is basically no technical competition, only economic competition. It has been shown in the past that this kills the progress of the technology. Are you not afraid of this or any ideas?
I agree with you with the first part, but this is already the situation these days. If you look at the operators these days, they are not competing with each other based on technology, right? They have a 4G network, probably they even have the same supplier. Excuse me? So the difference may be that they subscribe to one more feature than the other, you know, some optimization of channels or something like that. Technology is the same. So operators these days are not competing on technology from the infrastructure viewpoint. And of course, for the phones, they are not selling phones. They are reselling the phones that other people have. So in fact, the competition is based on the business models and the service they are providing to users. Whether this is bad, like we're saying, for technology, yes, I think so. If you look at the business guys working in telecoms, they see technology more and more like a commodity. You can buy it off the shelf. And that's why operators don't have research centers anymore. I mean, some claim they do, but what they are doing there is not research. So I think this is a fact. So it's bad for us engineers, I agree with you. But my hope, let's call it this way, let's put it this way, is that all these things are always cycles. Yeah? So one way or another, in a few years, people will realize that they need, again, technology to solve some problems that today they take for granted. If you go back to the 80s, so 1980, 81, 82, 83, 84, people working in radio were dead, let's put it this way. Because before the start of mobile communications, radio was fixed radio links. And this was a technology that had saturated already, as it has. So anyone, you would ask anyone, where are you going? I'm going to work in radio antennas or propagation. Are you crazy? Don't do that. This is a dead topic. I mean, there's nothing to be done there. It's all known. And then suddenly, with mobile communications, radio came to a new life, and there's still a lot to be done. These days, there is also, again, this trend, oh, radio is dead, there's nothing to be done, we know everything about propagation, and so on, which is not true for obvious reasons. You see, MIMO, you know MIMO, right? Multiple input, multiple output, is a good show that you can still do new things in radio and with the physics, with the laws of physics. You can take advantage of things, yeah? Fading was a bad thing, with MIMO became a good thing. So it may happen that in the future you have also other similar situations. It depends on our imagination somehow. But currently, yes, the trend is that technology can buy everything off the shelf, which is not true, of course. But I think there's a lot to be done. There are a lot of open problems. I would not say that in research we are coming to a dead end. On the opposite, there are plenty of new problems to be addressed.
Any other question? Okay, so thank you very much.
No, do we have 2 minutes? Yes? Because I mentioned the video, I want to show you the video, if you don't know the video. No, I have it here. Okay. I think I have it, let me check. Sorry guys, I need to search for it. Oops, what happened here? Huh? Sorry.
Emma.
No, let me start this. You know, anyone knows this video?
Emma. Emma. Emma.
Ha 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 ha!
It's a nice video, isn't it? Thank you, guys.